Hello everybody and welcome to the 23rd version of the Architects Bookshop Isolation Series. Hello to everybody who's isolated around the world. Hoping that this brings a little bit of connectivity to your isolation, particularly all you people in Melbourne. Naughty Melburnians. number 23. It's been a bloody big week, to be honest, for me. I felt a little bit like I wasn't going to keep doing these, so you can see I've moved location. Moved to the other side of the office because my computer kept crashing. I don't know if you noticed during the last one, there's a few problems with that going on. But yeah, tough week trying to deal with all the COVID issues. But you know, Rodney's awesome. So I thought, let's do it. Let's do Rodney. How are you, Rodney?
I'm well, thanks, Adam. How are you going?
I'm okay. Had a tough week, but I'm okay. How about you?
Oh, not bad. I noticed that you'd fallen behind a bit, so I took the liberty of making my own advert. I hope you didn't mind.
I love it. I wish everyone would do that. That'd be awesome.
Running out of time.
Yeah. How's it been going, Melbourne?
Yeah, not so bad. We're getting through it. I think, hopefully there's just one more week to go and we should be fine, but still squeezing some time in to get to the factory, which has been really good. Keep the kids will be at school next week, so hopefully sort of back to a semi-normal pretty soon.
Yeah, how many kids have you got?
Two, 8-year-old and a 5-year-old, Albert and Eva.
Awesome. So,
yeah, they keep us on our toes.
Yeah, absolutely, particularly while you're trying to homeschool as well.
Yeah, that's right. So my partner's been fantastic at that.
Yeah. Awesome. So tonight, we're going to have a chat about your work. Obviously, I met Rodney, probably you were on the National Juries group. How long ago was that?
Oh, four years ago.
Right. And yeah. I think that was really awesome to meet you there. And then you got to know a little bit more about what you were doing at my studio, done some amazing projects. And I think you've been around for about 10 years, that's right?
13 years.
Yeah, since nice. March. That's good. Yeah. And how are we going with the how many staff now?
I think there's around 10 or so, even flowing at the moment. Yeah.
Right. So without further ado, Rodney won the 2019 Emerging Architects Award nationally in Australia, which is pretty phenomenal. And I think one of the things I really love about their work is the kind of investigative, playful, joyous nature of what Mark Studio does. So without further ado, Rodney, over to you.
Thanks, Ed. Thanks very much. I probably should just start by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land from where I sit and throughout Australia, wherever you might be watching this, and recognise their continual connection to land, waters and culture. We pay our respects to the elders past and present and emerging. And to you, Ads, for putting this lockdown lecture series on. Thank you very much. It's been a real joy to play whilst working in ISO.
Awesome, I'm glad you enjoyed it.
Yeah, no, it's been great. Cheers, mate. So the first slide here is really justification of where I'm sitting today. I'm allowed to be a manufacturer. We have a manufacturing business. We're just not allowed to be architects in our own office at the moment. So there's this strange dichotomy happening in Melbourne at the moment. So I thought I'd start off with showing you a bit of furniture design, a bit of manufacturing. We had a big order recently of 4 stools. So here I am. I think what really underpins the studio, though, is the space and the thinking around certain techniques and through certain technologies that lead to this notion of making or of manufacturing. We've been getting to the point recently where we've started to take this a little bit further and develop amplifiers and speakers and trying to look at ways that audio can be integrated better with interiors and with houses as well. So with Julian Canterbury, we've started a sort of side offshoot called Rigmarole Design. And basically through that vehicle, there's this playing that's happening. But as I mentioned, it's really something that does underpin the thinking here at March. And we like to, you know, think of ourselves as actually manufacturing architecture and finding the moments where small little wins in manufacturing can lead to an outcome that can get built or an outcome that can change the course of an architecture. And the second part, obviously, is the studio being a really valuable part of what we do. I think we might have suffered more than most architecture practices recently just because we don't have the space and the ability to collaborate like we usually would. We're very proud of our office. Anne-Laure and I purchased the building with some friends of ours who are builders, Scott and Phoebe, and it just so happens that it was designed by my... film. We love film and the kind of knowing or watchful eye looking over us as a kind of a key look at technology. When we bought the building, we were fortunate enough to get this book with it as well that the previous owner gave us. So the building was designed for Wes Lofts and Ron Barassi, Go Blues. They were Carlton footballers at the time, and they had a packaging company. So it's 1972, it's Japanese brutalism, it's a fantastic looking building, and I don't know how this receptionist sat underneath those stairs. The amount of stuff that falls down those stairs is pretty amazing. Probably Australia's most inefficient building until we put a 30 kilowatt solar farm on the roof, and now actually it performs quite well. And funnily enough, also in this magazine is probably Australia's second most inefficient building, which is this tower here. That happens to be where I live, Adam. here it is advertising, the wonders of concrete. There's not one straight floor in the place. But here it is here, 99 Spring Street. Fantastic location, nice, yeah. Generous kind of spaces. But we seem to be trapped in the 70s here at March. The building actually recently got heritage listing or advice to be heritage listed. And when reading the recommendation, one of the sightings was its marvellously intact foyer. Now, we completed this foyer in 2016, so we're also heritage architects from the 1970s, and we do like to play in this realm, and we sort of feel the most comfortable spinning things, bending metal, using technologies that have been around and available for a long time, and finding ways to cross that over with digital technology. This is an apartment we did for a painter and a friend of ours in Falls Creek. He came to us and said, he wanted a 1970s Japanese spaceship. No problems, we can do that. So I thought I'd show you this film quickly. It only goes for a couple of minutes. It usually just gets me kind of fired up. It's from 10 years ago, and the soundtrack is from the Chemical Brothers. They might try and pull it down for you later, but can you hear that?
Yeah.
Dancing, Adam?
Oh my god, I'm so dancing. That's awesome.
So in 2010 we were asked to do a competition for a Swiss watch company I can't say the name of because we're under a non-disclosure agreement, And we came up with this particular concept and we won it, and it was pretty amazing. But it was really about, for us, a bit of a turning point with how you might begin to take interior space and inject architecture. Obviously, we were trying to create a store that could sort of change, you know, referencing the Swatch watches and also trying to reference time. March began in 2007, which was the start of the GFC, and now we're in 2020. It feels like a lot's happened, but not much has changed. When we started...
It's so right. It's like, oh my God, it's just like on rewind. We're on rewind.
Isn't it? Here we go again. Let's start.
God, I'm not sure I've got another one in me, Rodney.
We even started talking about going and getting some grants the other day. So these kinds of images started emerging out of the US, obviously, as a result of the GFC and the dot-com kind of revolution that was upon us. And this urban decay, this fragility of this whole capitalistic world really began to underpin March's thinking. Another one that sort of struck me was when I was 18 at the Tate in London and saw this Gursky image in full, and the kind of this saturation of manufactured items, and started thinking through the waste that we have and that we create, that's kind of everywhere around us, and really wanted to build a company that talked in some manner about that. The way in which we then started, you know, visualizing the world through Google Earth. So we were really at the start of the kind of digital revolution going through university and understanding these manufactured landscapes also started underpinning our work. And being big film buffs, Anne-Laure introduced me to Jacques Tati when I met her. And, you know, this guy spent his entire life talking about the dichotomy and the difference between the village and modern architecture, and in many ways sort of highlighted that the village or the city or the organic or the accidental is somehow more inherently interesting than something that's conceived and completely designed. And so the first company we had pretty much straight out of uni was a company called Diatribe with a couple of other partners, Mark Raggett and Campbell Drake. And we had this opportunity to design a pop-up bar in Melbourne's Tattersalls Lane. And this was really as the GFC was starting to take hold. It's an assemblage, quite a robust assemblage of containers and shipping pallets. And actually today you can go online and buy one of these and they'll ship it to you with all the parts in it. What we were kind of amazed about was the way that it kind of took on this cult status. You can see it here in one of a, you know, high production ad that Melbourne produced to spruik its laneways and its kind of individuality. And it also got the front cover of Architecture Australia. And we were amazed. And then we sort of started flicking through and noticed that we hadn't been credited. And we later found out that it was in there because they didn't know it had been designed, and we sort of showed them the drawing, the town planning application. A bit embarrassing, but it was a really interesting idea that you could design something and someone would think it's not designed. And this is a shot that Peter Bennett took for us recently, as this thing's taken on its own life, and really in many ways it's an aperture for all this stuff to kind of exist around. And that became the more interesting side of architecture and design for us. And we started testing it earlier on with these cardboard buildings, where we basically had kids come in and project their imaginings of another place, to create these environments that would be haphazard and completely ill-conceived in many ways to celebrate the accident. And
where did you make those, Rodney?
So the last one was in Perth, without a building permit or a structural engineer, and we're happy to say it lasted 10 days.
Awesome.
Only rained once, which was good. The entire thing was made out of cardboard. And the one before that was just down at Federation Square at Art Play.
Mm-hmm.
And we didn't know really how to make buildings out of anything else, because studied at RMIT. and but we knew how to use a box cutter, and that was what was all that mattered. So the first installations were these kind of Boolean exercises made out of paper. We worked for the State of Design through Fleur Watson and made these event spaces out of yellow tracing paper. Still got some of that tracing paper. You know, dragging out old projectors and sort of turning it into a jewelry exhibition. It accidentally melted one of the pieces. She wasn't very happy about that. So it was a bit of a rough start. And then Aesop saw us dragging all this cardboard up into our studio. We were in Bouverie Street at the time, and they were next door, and asked us to start designing stores for them. And that began this kind of relationship. And these investigations into one material, it was sort of like, oh, then they let us use string, you know, that was pretty exciting. So this one was in Singapore, we named it Stringapore. And on we went with excess bottles and really trying to understand one material and what that material could do, and use technology and use our skill set to try to drag out an interior that might be best suited for that one material. So here you can see the kind of jig that we made with laser cut plywood, which we obviously never do again, because we did it once. And we built this thing ourselves in Melbourne and had to get it over to Adelaide. So had to design boxes that it could be slid into and panelize it so a builder could lift it above his head on a ladder. And the act of transportation and the constraint of the store became responsible for the architecture, which we found super interesting. And the walls and the counter became the boxes that we unpacked it from. And then off we went on a kind of merry kind of way, you know, investigating new materials, trying to take digital technology and break it apart a bit so it wasn't so predictable, through to doing work for Daniel Kiriko at his bakery, making a massive bread basket, or stacking timber to try to make a shelter and try to use one material for one purpose. And on it went with hoarding boards in Switzerland to porcelain, LVL beams, recycled timber, cork, building a tensegrity structure out of aluminium.
Oh God, you've pretty much done every Aesop store.
We've done a few. We haven't done every single one. This was a cracker. They we couldn't actually physically fix into any of the store because apparently this is Sydney's oldest shop.
Oh yeah, in the rocks.
So we had to build this freestanding structure inside, and you know, what better way to do it than to build a tensegrity? I mean, we had no idea how to do that, but anyway, we did it. We've done steel, massive steel doors. We've done Louis Vuitton straps. We've done copper in Geneva. You know, Geneva just feels like the kind of place it's okay to use heaps of copper. Done brass, fiberglass, concrete at hotel, glass bricks that you walk on. And it sort of all then came to this point where we started thinking, well, how do we begin to turn this into architecture? And a competition entry for the National Gallery Pavilion was for us a bit of a pinnacle in sort of understanding and letting go and letting material really inform the whole series of ideas. We looked at reusing John Waters' pavilion from the year before, stripping it apart, then flipping it upside down and creating a completely new form out of the steel that then would have this amphitheater kind of strung over the top of it. And underneath would be this sea of technicolored rope that sort of, you know, getting down into the process of polypropylene rope and how you can actually begin to turn it into a gradient, finding a supplier that helped us to do so, and then sort of creating this incredible kind of pavilion sort of backdrop piece that was talking about a lot of ideas at the time that were not going through. The next sort of side of learning and thinking centres around the way in which you have to represent some of these things. And I think we've sort of, you know, still trying to learn. This was obviously before the days of Grasshopper. Sam Rice, who's a very good friend and worked with us for a long time, was sort of rewriting scripts and doing his own scripting to be able to generate these really heavy, complex models that had certain families, and then the representation of that and trying to articulate something that looks like it's
random.
Been made up on site, basically. And, you know, obviously if it had, it would never actually work.
That's one of your successful things is making it look effortless.
Oh, thanks, mate.
People literally say to me, oh, they just stacked some timber in the lobby. And I'm like, oh my God, could you imagine how long that would have taken to just stack the timber?
I mean, the key for the suspended timber was that every rod had to be, pin to be drilled in the right spot.
Oh my God.
You know, CNC machines have made that easier for us, but in the beginning it was all fairly manual and we were relying on the guy at the steel factory to get the hole in the right spot. And so when we purchased the building, we were really keen to turn the back part where Barassi and Lofts were doing their packaging into a working factory, and invested in a CNC machine and really started to talk about this idea of fabrication and testing ideas, so that it's okay to whip up a sample and show a builder, you know, potentially this is how you might be able to do it. But in many ways, a lot of the testing that we do is just because we're bored and we want to see what happens. But, you know, the office has become a bit of a library of things, and we did get to the point that we were building, you know, staff and sending it out, and I think we've learned that that's not what we're interested in, but certainly interested in new technologies, the Followgram guys showing us how their kit works, and having the space to be able to do that has been a real game changer for us. And even though we sort of, you know, invested in this $100,000 machine and didn't know what we were going to use it for,
yeah,
I think now we can't think how we'd exist without it. So a bit of a turning point for us, and in many ways why we are a studio and not an office. So I thought I'd start with a house in Brighton that we did a couple of years ago. This was the block when we were commissioned to do it. The client bought it with this house on it. The house didn't fit within the res code envelope, so that was a bit problematic. It was a very long block, quite narrow, and in Bayside they have this double kind of res code thing that we didn't know about until we started trying to get building permits. And Brighton, for those who don't know, is it's an interesting suburb. It's quite closed off. There's no sense of community. Quite large walls, kind of street fronting. And in terms of the ambition of the client and the size of the site, the early sketches became this idea of connecting the outside and the inside, but also retreating from the street, coming back the 9 meters required by Resco, and then sort of gifting back this front yard to the streetscape so that you didn't have a wall hard up against it. And we sort of went out of our way to make this image look as kind of shocking as possible to the client, and said, this is what we've come up with. Do you like it? He's like, I love it. Keep going. Like, okay, this could go quite well. And off we went on our merry way, designing this thing that the neighbor referred to as an oil rig. And it was sort of an association we weren't too displeased with. So you get this massive blade at the front of the house that is planted out with native grasses. Mm. There's this entrance by a car. There's a March Studio letterbox, which has become a bit of a thing for us. Mm. The entrance by foot down the other side, and this thing sort of hunkers down and sits within itself. In plan, it's about 7.5 meters wide. This strip that runs all the way through and goes from garage, study, living, kitchen, and then becomes a swimming pool. And then upstairs is where the sleeping spaces are, where the bedrooms are.
Lots of, amazing level of confidence from the client for your first house, yeah?
We've done a few other houses before this. This is about our fifth house, I think.
Right, okay.
Yeah, but certainly the one that sort of captured everything for us and the thinking around manufacturing. And certainly a client that absolutely said, just go for it, boys. Like, guys, just go crazy. So he owns a steel company, and so the basic part mm-hmm. of the brief was that you have to use steel.
Mm-hmm.
The house had to be sunk down about half a metre to get it within the res code envelope, and it became about these infrastructural elements and moves, you know, like freeway barriers and retaining walls, and getting the whole site kind of retained so that we could get it within the planning. And obviously, you know, larger moves like the front escarpment, and then the rear swimming pool, all these landscape elements that feel like they're almost within the house. The living areas on the ground floor, connecting as much as they can to outside. And there was this attempt to really try to warm the place up through these exposed trusses, to not be shy about mixing different materials together. We all sort of shared this love of warehouse spaces, and we really wanted to emulate, you know, the light quality and the shadow play that you might get in some of those environments. And then these six kind of major trusses that sit on top that become these pergolas to grow a deciduous vine across to the north that separate the floors, and also began this thinking around a kit of parts in a house. And really fortunate to work with, you know, everything in 3D, all the shop drawings being checked in 3D, so that you could sort of land this piece and clip straight to it and continue on your merry way, and everything working, which was a real joy and sort of something that we don't find as much in many public projects or even in the commercial world, which, you know, shocks us a little bit from time to time. the connection details of all these things coming together, the front
garage door
mm. that's, yeah, it's beautiful. Pretty much just one big hydraulic jack, and then the bedrooms up top that change kind of character again and become much warmer, all timber. The res code envelope, you can really feel it kind of pressing into the side of you, but rather than sort of making this space kind of smaller, just accepting it and doing everything around it so the door, you know, gets a chamfer cut out.
I can't believe you can actually build these houses, a house like this in Melbourne, without a planning permit.
That's crazy.
That's unbelievable. Like, this would take about 7 years to get approved in Sydney. That's fantastic.
I'm going to Brighton. our bathrooms are often always curved because we hate kind of tiles meeting. So that all sort of makes sense. And then the real hero of the project becomes this big copper screen that sits around it. And, you know, due to the width of the property, had to be there for overlooking, and also to keep the northern sun off. And Julian was pretty obsessed with these bamboo blinds at the time. Had a few of them in his house. They cost about $3 from Bunnings. And it's sort of this irregular regularity that we've sort of always been interested in. And the way in which they then, when the sun finds its way through, it sort of gives this ripple effect hitting the ground. So we really wanted to emulate that, but obviously we couldn't make the thing out of bamboo, and started searching around for a material with longevity. And, you know, designing this one really through the model and weaving copper wire through these vertical elements to create this skin and this facade, and then presenting it to the client, obviously, and him saying, I love it, let's do it. And then trying to go, okay, well, we've got to work out how to build
how
this thing.
How do we make it now?
So back into the computer, and Julian found this copper segment that they use in bus bars. Like, this is stuff that you use in massive electrical distribution boards. And with Julian's kind of history studying electrical engineering, he knew about it, and we managed to find some. And then it was, well, how do you create the vertical element with enough variation in it so that we could capture that movement? So that was sort of done, had to be stainless steel so that there wasn't any similar metal corrosion. And at this point, because we'd sort of gone ahead with the builder and it was all happening on site, it was pretty hard to cost this thing. So we sort of left it out of the budget, and we gave them this drawing, which was basically how it would connect. but on closer inspection, it doesn't even connect down the bottom. My bad. And we said, look, just allow 2 weeks to put the thing up. So the next day we came back and we sent the files off to the water jetter. These things have arrived on site. They could go in any order. It didn't really matter because the prongs are just moving up and down slightly. And within a day, they were installed. And we tested this thoroughly, but we hadn't wrapped our head around how to attach the copper at the point in time. So off we went again and developed this clipping system. The top one, it was 3 parts, and it was not going to be possible with, you know, builder's fingers to be able to put the whole thing together. And then sort of established this folded mechanism that could slide over the top and be secured either side. The last iteration is the electro-polished one. And this for us is where it all starts beginning to work, because manufacturing industries in Melbourne, most of them have been closed down because of the car industry, but there are people that know more about digital technology than, you know, than builders, basically. So we send this straight to a guy, he sends us back a prototype instantly. You know, you tick it off and away you go. And these clips all arrived on site actually in ESOP boxes, because ESOP get all their balm dispensers through them as well. And then obviously just use their boxes for something else. So nice kind of, it was a bit of a trip actually.
Serendipity.
There's one right there on the ground.
There you go.
So from our balm dispensers to then to this, it was kind of interesting. And that's Albert there checking out the site.
I love Albert.
6 years old and loving it. And so this thing, it was a brilliant kind of surprise to see the way in which the different metals work together, and the way in which it changes as well during certain light, it becomes backlit or not. It was a joy, and really one of those things that sort of reinforces the thinking behind just unlocking that clip so that this thing could be built and installed. The basement, I think by this time, we were really stretching the relationship with the builder, and we'd sort of come to them with this design. Obviously, you know, had to get these cars down there, a perforated stair that takes it down, and a fireman's pole as well. But we sort of came to them with this design. We finally got approval on the theatre, and they're like, wow, we're going to build that. And again, sort of managed to, break it down to basics and start suggesting that there was this backing board made of MDF. And really the key kind of part for this one is just a bracket. And the bracket has got different angles. It's folded slightly differently. And, once you put them all in the right order, it'll all work out. And the builders put that together for us and then made us come and stick all the panels on. So
they're like, if you're going to make us do it, you're going to do it.
Exactly. So, it's another kind of crazy space in this in this mega house. The next project, how am I going for time?
We're about halfway.
Okay, cool. The next one I thought I'd show, this was a real joy for us because it was the first time we ever got kind of shortlisted in a public EOI. We teamed up with Openwork, who are fantastic, obviously, and Woodcast, who are interpretive designers and really great. And the first thing we had to do was really, get into the mood. So
I love this. This is fantastic. Oh, it's fantastic.
So, as you're from Melbourne, aren't you?
Yeah.
How much Puffing Billy means to Melbournians,
absolutely.
Right?
Absolutely.
It's like, it's the best thing to ever happen to you when you're a kid, to go to Puffing Billy and to ride on the train. And so we built a consultant team where we basically employed someone to Photoshop hats on them.
I love this. This is fantastic.
So that was Charlie's job. And the proposal, it didn't really matter. We were more concerned about the hats. But the proposal sits at the end of Lakeside Station, so really an extension to the existing station as a way of getting more trains through. That's my daughter, Eva, owning it. Lakeside Station, you know, it's constantly full of trains, and the whole idea was to extend the platform, but to also create this museum and learning centre as well, and a reception centre. And obviously, having young kids at the time, we found ourselves out at Eltham quite a bit on the miniature trains. Yeah. And there's this point where you fly through these rockler pipes that have just been kind of laid throughout. And the scheme really became about this idea of tunneling and flying through a pipe, but also trying to capture, you know, that moment where you go over the truss bridge and all the kids, well, I don't think they're allowed to do it anymore, were hanging off the edge.
Used to hang off the edge of a, it was awesome.
Yeah, face full of soot. And then this kind of idea of just rolling down the hill. So, you know, this is Mark's sort of landscaping contribution. Like, that's great. That's and then supporting this infrastructure, this, you know, almost clumsy detailing that we're quite good at, with the utilitarian nature of exposed bolts and the heaviness of it all, that, again, we're sort of very much into, with quite a sensitive landscape. I mean, they put this thing through a rainforest and then the rainforest came back. But on one side, you've got these introduced landscapes, and on the other, you've got native, and then it all swaps over again and flips. And the site itself is kind of this condition of edges where you're on the edge of a road, on the edge of a railway, on the edge of a lake, and sort of identifying the fact that the curve is like a perfect arc, so it sort of makes sense. I mean, the railway track basically takes the contour of the land. It's sort of like, duh, okay, that makes sense. and then using that as a way of beginning to arrange the program through a series of chambers, extending the platform and putting the program sort of into these chambers that can then be connected by something else. And then this idea of burying it all. The brief was fairly specific. It said no more than two stories. So we thought if we buried a story, we might be able to sneak away with three. Didn't work. But the landscape meant it would sort of fall down between these tunnels and then join back up with the platform. So you'd have these multiple opportunities to sort of connect back from the bus drop-off back down and create these kind of hidey hole areas. And I mean, the other thing with the rainforest, every single time you go there, it's raining. So if we could elevate the building above, you could create this kind of shelter with the building itself. A series of connections that talked about, you know, getting buses in there, and this upper floor that sort of levitates above was for a reception center, I've heard since has been taken out of the brief, but you know, we sort of aligned it with the boat shed that was there at the moment, because we thought, well, if it works for them, it works for us. Mm-hmm. And here's the kind of process of us just delicately removing those trees, protecting the ones that are there, and you know, cutting and filling these tunnels in, you know, seamlessly, Adam. Like, nothing has happened. Obviously, there were some locals to consider there. This is our mid non-level, which is basically a kind of a bridge that gives you that access point to the platform, so that if you hear the train and you've just arrived, you can sprint down there and see it before it takes off again, because that's love obviously it. The most important thing. And then the upper floor sits on the top. So, sorry, my computer seems to be lagging a bit. The landscape contribution was very much just drawing a line through the whole site and saying, this is native, this is introduced.
Yeah.
And a series of pathways in between that began to reference, obviously, railway sleepers and all sorts of kind of railway terminology and technology, or want for a better word, with these large concrete pipes that sort of became these arrival zones. So as I mentioned, you know, school kids would come in one way, and if you came in by train, you'd come another way. And if you were a school kid, you could drop all your bags and go to the bathroom and then run down this kind of corridor to the end, where we thought it'd be great to have this kind of bridge that got as close as it could before you burn your face off from the steam that was pouring out of the top of the train. And as you can see, two-story building. We've always wanted to do something with concrete tunnels and pipes, and we've you know, these ones are the best, the goat ones, but they're a little bit impractical. So we went for a three-pin arch profile, that one in the middle, because it fit a train inside it. And these really became the chambers that would be sunk in. There was obviously back of house requirements and, you know, front ticket sales, the core that, that holds the building above but also becomes the main circulation, the gift shop, and then the learning spaces, and a theatrette as well, which is all, you know, fairly unapologetic with what it is. It's concrete, it's timber, sleepers laid on the ground and sanded off, and timber seats as well. And the exhibition that Paul had designed for us was this amazing kind of rotating everything on tracks situation. The relationship to the heritage listed station and the way it sat in the landscape. Obviously, this idea of bridging being something that was explored and looked into quite a fair bit. The Richardson House, one of my favourite houses in Melbourne, you know, like how can you ignore it?
Yeah.
And then all the switching stations that are all elevated. So we sort of tried to really embed in our competition that this was all possible. But I guess the typology of the bridge then became the one that you had as a kid on your model railway track, as a kind of vernacular that would sort of suggest this is a bridge. And then the kind of joy became, well, how do you use that truss and express it all the way through the building so that it becomes the interior, the lighting, the air conditioning vents, and just bend those kind of things slightly in the same way that the air intakes do. And this was our final proposal. Our rendering friends at Doug and Wolf took some liberty on the height of the trees, but we sort of thought, you know what, it's a fantasy, let's just
why
go
not?
For it.
Why not?
Why not? Why not indeed? And the feedback we had from the client was they were worried it was going to detract from the Puffinbilly experience.
Oh,
so anyway.
Did you want to punch somebody?
Since then I've heard the briefs change quite a lot. So it taught us a lot about, you know, how you deal with those pitches, I guess. I think they actually said before we went into it, they had a clear winner. And then after we presented, the winner changed. So that either means I'm a really bad presenter or we just showed too much. So it was great. Simon from BKK had a bit of a debrief session at his studio, and it was really, really great to see everyone's scheme.
Mm.
The next one I think you've seen, the Kingborough Community Hub.
Yeah.
So this is a community centre down in Kingston in Tasmania. For those who don't know, Kingston is south of Hobart on your way to Bruny Island. The community centre sits back here. It's sort of strange one where they've occupied the kind of coastal area, and then the city sort of eventually fell back and they created a new hub through there. So there's this kind of connection, non-connection from the sea at Storm Bay beyond, and Opossum Bay sitting on the other side. The site itself was the old Kingston High School. So if you track your way through near maps, you'll get kind of images like this, and they moved the school up the hill to a far better facility. Can't recall the architect, but you know, much better than what they had. And when we got there, there was just this building left. So you can see it there. It was a competition, and they invited people to come up with a proposal, and they said, look, you can keep the building or you can demolish it. This was the building, again, 1972, everything in my
life. You are stuck in the 70s.
I'm stuck in the 70s. It's just unbelievable. And, you know, so not a great building, public works department, but, you know, a big building, a lot of stuff there.
Volume.
To just say, okay, let's just get rid of it and that's the end of that.
Yeah.
And the one thing that I think, you know, the graffiti guy picked up on was this kind of insane grid that the thing had. You assholes, there was nothing wrong here. Obviously, there was a bit of kind of
a bit of community angst.
People loved this place, so what better than to get some architects in from Melbourne? But we really took cues from the building. We wanted to, you know, keep the material palette super simple: timber, concrete, and concrete, and then add color through paint, which still might occur. But this column grid became the thing that really stuck with us. And we sort of, that's the existing building. We sat this thing literally straight on top of that column grid. And since the early renders, it was always connecting this large parasol to the column grid and extending beyond it because we could, because it was, you know, structurally over-engineered. Mm. And as the building developed and then, you know, finally kind of got built, it sort of became apparent that really with what we've made was this quite incredibly large shed or hangar of sorts.
Yeah.
And to do that, we sort of embodied a whole bunch of different techniques and technologies that we've wanted to use for a while, one of them being obviously Aramax and an incredible kind of product that it is. So Anne Law, my partner, and also at the office as creative director, said, no, they need a rebrand. So she came up with a new logo for them, and this became the kind of signifier to the front of the building. I was speaking with Cameron Broon about the project, and he mentioned Ian McDougall referring to Bunnings Warehouse being the only real true community centre these days because... you know, the local netball team can sell sausages out the front.
Yeah.
And it for us, it became this kind of way of identifying the building without doing the community centre thing, which is, you know, covering it in colour and saying we are community. But yeah. This, you know, this kind of a signifier that everyone could identify with that could sit back beyond the back of the kind of shopping strip, but also exist within that landscape is something that was... you know, the idea and the pitch to council. And so when we got on board, there was this idea of all these different programs that could go in, and council also had the town square in the wrong spot, and so we sort of flipped it around and showed them some colourful diagrams and said that you can just inject all of this around this town square and have solar exposure. And what we sort of very quickly realised was that we didn't really know why we were building this building. So we went out and did a bit of a survey to try to find out what it was that the community wanted to see down there. Mm-hmm. You know, it took all this analysis and took it back to the studio and tried to understand it and unpack it. Lots of bike racks were demanded, even though there sort of wasn't really anything there. I should probably mm-hmm. point out that the building... is the first of a town that's going to be built around it. These are the bike racks being used, done a monkey bar. And from that, we began to unpack the potential usages of the project and really write ourselves a brief and say, well, this is how we think you should use it. But ultimately, it became about, you know, the most amount of flexibility as possible. So we were kind of taken by these floor graphics that were there.
Yeah.
To begin with, where, you know, you could sense there was this life beforehand, and Anne Law had been sort of doing these projects for Aspect, these level crossing removals all throughout Melbourne, you know, each one of them bigger than any project March had ever built. we want some of that. Mm. So off we went on this journey to do this floor graphic that was sort of loosely trying to describe the way in which you could use the space, be it basketball or car show, et cetera.
Yep.
And what we found was that it became the talking point with council and the councillors. And, you know, one would say it's too blue, the other would say it was too red. And so we sort of kept redesigning and redesigning these things until they got reduced down to pretty much just white line work. So from the early kind of conception of trying to populate this space and give it some sort of dynamic community feeling, we ended up with this.
Don't you wish there was a res code for community buildings?
But then, you know, as if you build it, they will come, and yeah. They did. And we started realizing, you know, the couple of times I've seen it function, it doesn't matter.
Yeah,
and,
totally.
You know, someone's going to bring a Knight Frank tent and put it underneath a roof.
Of course. You know?
Of course, why wouldn't you?
Exactly.
And it doesn't matter how many times you try to imagine how it's going to be used and, you know, children frolicking around,
yeah,
they're going to put the food trucks right
there. Of course.
So it was sort of okay, and it's being used, which is
awesome.
Yeah. So just running through the 72 building, keeping the columns and the concrete footings was, you know, saved us about 5-6 months of being in the ground. And then, you know, building around that structure, adding new kind of services. There's offices there, obviously back of house, co-working spaces, which are all, again, pretty utilitarian. There's a cafe, which at the moment's being used for a display suite for the houses that they're building around, community gardens, and this idea that you could have a kind of show inside whilst doing something else outside, the ability to play a full court game of basketball, but then connect the whole space together by lifting this 18-meter airport hangar door covered in, polypropylene that just sort of flies up. That's a massive projector sitting beside it. It's me cleaning up for the opening, as you can see that, you know, we're all ready to go. And the view back onto Kunyali over the back. And so, you know, you get this sense, the floor here still hasn't been finished, but you get the sense of this really flexible and versatile space that you can set up different events in. And it is a big shed. Car shows, what have you. There's this idea to create this internal street, so that sort of stays open 24/7, and different events can happen, you know, off to the side or around. And you sort of imagined, you know, picking up your daughter from gymnastics after it and sitting on the steps under shelter. So it sort of gave those panoptics and gave that clarity to the building.
Yeah.
But then the ability to, you know, open everything up and cut across the side as well. The materials, as I mentioned, are fairly robust, galvanized metal, massive wayfinding done by Hamlor. And then the roof, which is the real kind of hero. And when we designed it, we imagined it in CLT, and you know, we were a bit ignorant at the time. We thought, okay, well, CLT is the way of the future. We'll do it in that. It's Tassie. They've got heaps of timber. Sort of found out pretty quickly that they didn't have any CLT technology, and nah, mate, you're going to have to build it out of steel. And then we thought, okay, well, that's fine. That looks cool as well. So we'll keep that. But, you know, understandably, council had concerns with nesting and birds, you know, roosting in there. But it was this kind of interesting kind of roundabout that we went to. And in the end, we got, you know, what the original vision was. We're pretty amazed how intact the design is actually from the competition scheme. And the roof that I mentioned in this Aramax, I don't know if you guys have used that before, but it basically, they land this container on site and they just roll out these coils and they thread it through and lift this stuff up with a crane. It looks like a noodle going up, and then when they fix it off, it becomes rigid and beautiful.
It's beautiful.
Incredible material that really is the hero of the project. So that's the community hub, and you know, it's been a really fantastic stepping stone for us to start getting into more public work and to go beyond obviously some of the earlier thinking. And some of the other projects that we've been doing recently, teaming up with larger offices. So this one, we were invited by PTW to join them and Collins and Turner on a hotel tower in Sydney in Bligh Street. And a really fantastic opportunity to test some of those ideas. Hugh sort of came to the table with this image, Oliver Ellison, the waterfall in Versailles. And he's like, why don't we just make the building like that? I was like, well, pools are cool. Let's do something based on water. you know, Sydney has heaps of pools. It's kind of in your DNA. And
yeah.
Bligh Street, it's like, where are the pools?
Yeah.
So next door, the Soderson building, City Mutual building, that has this crinkle cut facade. This is our site here on the left. Mm-hmm. And beginning to sort of, you know, reinforce that street wall height by taking the same kind of pleated facade and extending it across, but then identifying the need to open up the building at lower level to get that kind of widening of the street. Simon from PTW was really keen to do. And then this act of eroding this thing, talking about kind of the sandstone cliffs in Sydney and the way that they kind of erode over time, and angling it so that it gets kind of, you know, acceptable sunlight, but protects it from the western sunlight as well. So this kind of one directional facade that, you know, could be completely organic, but is entirely conceived, and sort of imagine these terracotta fluted kind of facade hanging with planting mixing through it in this kind of traversable landscape that tried to extend the hospitality offering as well, so that you didn't just have one floor, you had two floors, and you could then begin to suggest that that tenancy can sort of have these two decks or beer gardens so that after work you can go somewhere and sit outside and have a drink and sit under this incredible kind of cave-like facade with that open square that, you know, again, a food truck's going to pop up in there at one stage. And the first of many pools in the building sits under that front square so that, you know, during the day you could sort of spa underneath this square.
Gorgeous.
While going to work, and introducing these lights into the floor paving so that as people are walking across them, there's sort of, you get a sense of the movement above, and you're just sort of hanging out underneath. And then the facade, so picking up on this idea of the waterfall and of cascading water, and Julien, or Fulien as we call him, French Julien at the studio, is just this kind of, you know, grasshopper lord, and the way in which he can sort of begin to unpack and control and script, and a series of diagrams that looked at the way in which, obviously, at lower levels there was more people looking into the hotel, so you would have more screening at that point. And as you go up the building and wanted to get the views to the harbour and less buildings, this thing could sort of transform, and through a mixture of different colours and ceramics, you begin to create these rooms where every single one of them was different. We sort of kept it all kind of beachy, and the interiors kind of reflected this kind of this attitude. And then on the rooftop, this is from Collins and Turner, this incredible vision of this pool that again wraps around the whole building and sort of gives you the ability to swim up to the facade and get the views beyond. How are we going for time?
3 minutes.
3 minutes. Okay, we'll make this the second last. This was really an investigation. This was a project we were asked to do for the Jackalope Group, an art piece called The Rain Room by Random International that we were invited to house temporarily above the Prince of Wales car park in Melbourne. And an incredible art piece that you walk through, and it turns off the rain as you walk through it. But architecturally, it sort of just needed to resolve a few issues, which were like, how do you get wheelchairs up there? Mm-hmm. And how do you sort of take this box and begin to do something else with it? Because the proportions were fairly set in stone. And again, it became this kind of exercise of unpacking a standard system, being scaffolding, and beginning to describe it through a series of drawings and bill of quantities that could be controlled so that we could get the thing built to a budget. So the building itself really references, you know, this idea of a cloud, the way in which it sits above, and so this is kind of some of the documentation we do, which is just an Excel spreadsheet, and screen grabs. We love screen grabs. You sort of come up through the side and onto the rear car park where you line up and get funneled through. But really the building, yeah, it's attempting to be this kind of built cloud that blends into the grey skies of Melbourne, which are more often than not, unfortunately, as a way of really unlocking the potential of that site. So it was a fantastic project for us and a really fun opportunity in the beginning of a relationship that we're having with that client to do a hotel here in Melbourne, which will hopefully be happening soon. Mm-hmm. I'll leave it there.
You're going to leave it there?
Well, if I've only got 3 minutes, I think I've spoken for 3 minutes. The last project's crazy anyway. Oh, God. We got to the point where Julian was sort of saying, oh, when we cut a sheet, we've got to try and work out what we're doing with the offcuts. So we started making these box trusses out of timber. And really, it was just this kind of fascination with using waste or offcuts to create something structural or to create something spatial. And, you know, there's value in a shipping container, but it just, someone will buy a shipping container off you to do something with it. And there's value with sheltered space. It's just that shipping containers are the complete wrong proportion. So we started thinking about CLT and, you know, what that might mean if you upscaled it to create a kind of timber-framed CLT container. And obviously, you know, this idea that you could build this thing in a factory, CNC the whole thing, and then drop it in on a site, and people could customize them to their conditions and sort of add to them as they needed to. And each of these cabins would be this kind of manufactured piece of architecture that you could add different elements to or kind of or not. So with that kind of thinking in mind, we were invited to the Estonian Biennale, and we didn't really know where Estonia was, but they filmed the Stalker there, which was pretty amazing. And we started thinking about the way in which we could, you know, turn this thinking and this idea into a habitable tower that could be moved around. So you could own one of these things and you could pop it into this site, or you could pick it up and have a truck take it to a different site, and you would create these communities. And rather than, you know, property prices are the most expensive thing usually when it comes to a house. So this kind of alleviates those issues and those concerns and gives you the ability to have a personalized environment that you can adapt and change. So that was the sort of thinking of the project. And then from there, we began to, lost it here. Doesn't want to stop. Imagine this kind of 1 to 10 tower that we were going to build. The curator, Gal Reiser, was quite keen to have it inhabited as well. And so we sort of delivered these files to Estonia and flew over there and arrived, and it was all sitting there flat packed in quite a small bundle. And it was sort of proof of concept. You know, it was cut and pocketed the way we wanted it to be. And as we started assembling it, we sort of took over the entire exhibition space. So this thing just expanded and expanded and expanded and expanded. And we're like, actually, this is sort of working in terms of its efficiency of material. And, you know, I'm not a light guy, Adam, and I could climb up this thing completely solid. And it created this incredible, I mean, it's a structural model. It's a bit kind of dumb, but it gave this incredible sense of opportunity and space and differences that you might be able to imagine happening, or an architecture that could exist out of this system or out of this method that we were really interested in. And so we sort of began to imagine some of those plans and the way in which different people could plug in different buildings or, you know, put a swimming pool in if they wanted to. There was also, you know, looking into this idea that we might all be getting Uber drones around very, very soon, and the way in which you could sort of land one of those on top. It was just a really fun project that I think began to, you know, loosen up some of the thinking that sometimes, as you know, as architects, we sort of go through the processes and the rigmarole, and it's always good to do something a bit refreshing and something a bit crazy as well, and just go, you know what, it's a crazy idea. It's sort of something that we're interested in many ways, and we want to start looking into CLT and timber technology, and this is an avenue to do so. We were asked recently to do a charrette at the Aberdeen School of Architecture up in Gold Coast, and so it was a really great way to say, okay, well, here's all the files, we'll make a tower, and each student can basically fit one out, and at the end of the charrette, we'll put them together. And then we brought it back to Melbourne for Dale Hardiman's exhibition called Life and Death. And this opened on March, I think, 11th or March 10th or something. So We literally put the thing in there, erected it all, took the photos. There was an opening, and the next day we went COVID into lockdown.
Oh, gosh.
That was 7 months ago.
Jeez.
But, you know, a really beautiful kind of piece of capturing a whole bunch of energy that went into that workshop and that charrette. And I'm looking at it now, it's sitting over the side of the studio, towering over the top of me, reminding me that there's another normal, there's a new world that we can work towards, and it's an exciting future. Thanks, Ads.
Fantastic. Thank you. Thanks for coming along. Really appreciate it. And thanks for the push on this week.
The energy. Apologies to Graham.
Oh, no, it's awesome for the, it's awesome to have your energy involved in this. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, buddy.
All people
thanks
are saying they can't hear me. How are you not being able to hear me or all of that? I was just saying, I think the thing I love about Rodney's work is how playful and joyful it is, and that he delivers a project which is often not there at the start and then is there. He makes a project. I think it's really fantastic. So thank you. Really appreciate it. Thanks for coming on. We'll be in touch with everybody as to our next line of talks and speakers coming up. Stay in touch, please. If you can, subscribe to the YouTube because it's much easier for me to get in contact with you. So subscribe to the channel. Thanks, everybody. Rodney, we had over 300 people online at once tonight, so we're bringing lots of people together. That's a good thing.
Awesome. Thanks, mate. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure. We'll see you all soon. Thanks, everybody.
Bye.